Hey, it's Mel from Rap Rankings. To hear the full episode this clip comes from and all of the other episodes, check the link in the description, stop by raprankings.com, or search Rap Rankings on your favorite podcast platform. And please consider liking, subscribing, and commenting to help us grow the channel and continue our journey as hip-hop's first and premier extreme podcast.
It's the Electric Circus. We're on the road, you know, we're a traveling circus sideshow, and look who we found, Mel.
This is a distinguished man. Don't make him sound like a carny, like we found him.
We're the carnies. I'm saying in our travels with our circus, we've come upon a man who is a MC, a producer, he's a 3D animator, he's really a man of many talents. Perhaps his greatest talent, though, is being able to listen to perhaps the whole catalog of Rap Rankings. Please welcome the man of the hour, our special guest reviewer making his debut on the show, Jonathan Cloud.
What's good, y'all? What's good? What's going on?
Jonathan Cloud, I have to tell you, welcome to Rap Rankings and welcome to the Electric Circus.
You position yourself as like the ringleader of this circus. That was clearly no disrespect, but it was started before you, and you're like an honorary ringleader. Because wouldn't it really be like Questlove or Dilla or the Soul Clarions or whoever executive produced this thing? You just took over.
See, what happened was, if you really must know, they licensed the name of my circus from me.
Oh, brother. Yeah, sure. Okay. No, this is classic white man taking some shit.
And you ain't black.
Okay. But no, in all seriousness. Yeah, Jonathan Cloud, ladies and gentlemen. I was telling him briefly before I, you know, hit the big red button. I've known of this man. I've respected and admired this man from like a, not like a distance, but like I've seen your name probably once a week in my life for like 10 years. So it was like, you know, I don't have to go as far back as to where I first, because like, you know, that's a whole long time. Listeners know we were in a cult. Jonathan Cloud wasn't in that cult, but due to being in that cult, I may have, you know, seen his name. That was the first time I saw his name.
But while he was not in the cult, like this traveling carnival that happened to run into Jonathan Cloud in our travels, I feel like if he was sometimes around cult adjacent figures.
Yeah. You know, we were saying, you know, friend of the show, Van Buren, but I'm going to have to use his his maiden name real quick. Complex. I'll never forget. COM, capital P, capital L, 3, lowercase x, uppercase x. back when he was Complex, you know, he done some work with Jonathan Cloud. There were some other people I knew that had done work with Jonathan Cloud. And, you know, I was telling him, like, I don't think I ever actually spoke to him. He says he sent me stuff when I was in my Pizza Boy era. Yeah. If I never got back to you or anything, I'm a bum. I'm an asshole. Because here's the thing. I would never have ignored you because I admired you. Now, here's the thing. Not to say that the people who I ignored, it was like a complete lack of like respect, but I was familiar with you. So I must have just like, it slipped my mind or something. Yeah, listen, Moulz knows about me. Moulz, when you first reached out to me, I was on that mysterious shit, okay? Like DJ Khaled would say, you know, I was really in shyness, but it's just like, you know me. You had to like wrangle me by the neck, you know, and get me to lock in, but this ain't about me. I'm retired.
Listen, it may be about me because many years ago when I was working with said rapper Complex, I was executive producing his album, and perhaps we would not be here today if I had cut this man's song from the final track list.
Oh, we know about you. Were you considering cutting the Jonathan Cloud produced record?
I wouldn't have even given it a thought, but you want to know something, Mel?
What's that?
The things that you do in a past life will come back to haunt you in the present. And in this case, you know, this is a good haunting.
Well, listen, I'm looking at the track list. I got the original files in 2014. It has to be none other than the Complex record I Am Art featuring Mickey Fax, produced by Jonathan Cloud. Okay.
Yeah, that was the one.
That was a big record. I remember. Okay, because we was geeking out in the chat. I'm like, oh, he got Mickey Fax. We on, nigga. We weren't on Ron Howard voice, but it got posted on Two Dope Boys, and it was a good moment for us as a unit, as a family, you know. So in a way, I'd like to thank Jonathan Cloud for helping provide that moment to us as fledgling musicians when we ain't have shit, and I was eating bologna sandwiches. I'm still eating bologna sandwiches, but you know. Anyway. We're happy to have you. I'm happy to speak to you for like the first time ever. So
I'll tell you, all those producers that got your beats cut from that album. I mean, well, we don't speak, you know what I mean? So you might not even be hearing this, but you know, not everybody gets to be on the debut, you know?
That's right. That's right. But,
hey, look at all the work Salaam Remy did with Nas, and he's not on Illmatic.
I mean, yeah, not everybody gets to be on the debut. It's true. But, you know, I would say everybody gets to be on Rap Rankings, but that's not entirely true. I mean, we don't have any, like, ban lists or anything. But
it's just, you know, there's only but so many slots. And Jonathan Cloud actually was set to be on a Clips Hell Hath No Fury review originally. Mm-hmm. And I figured, this is way too close to the Clips mixtape review we're going to be doing. Let's push this one back a bit. Then I had him on something else, and we had to push it back. So we're finally here. After what feels like a year since he first reached out to me and said, hey, I'd love to be on the show.
Wow.
Yeah. You know what? Actually, I remember the first one was supposed to be we were talking about the Quasimodo one. I really regret not being on that shit, because that's like one of my favorite albums ever.
Okay.
I could have used a little more support in that episode for sure.
Oh, don't make it sound like that. I didn't bury that album. I mean, yeah. I mean, to Jonathan Cloud's point, we did. I don't think it's not in the record club or anything. But let me see. What was that? Season 5? Yeah. It got a 64.25%.
It's in my record club. It's in my personal record
club. It's in your record club. I liked, let me see. Okay, 11 out of 26. But so yeah, not great. But you like 21 out of 26. I guess you're right. You're not being bad faith Moulz. You kind of could have used some backup, but yeah. I do remember that. Yeah, he was you know, floated to be on that episode.
Yeah, that's in my whole circumference of shit that I like that Cool Keith, that type of shit. That would have been.
You like Common?
Maybe I could be on a Cool Keith one. Yeah.
Well, you know, I guess Moulz, it made sense for you to ask him that, because you know we've had Jesse on for Common reviews, just for him to come in and be like, Common's not a good rapper. Okay,
he came on for my favorite album of all time, and maybe the worst Common album to come on and make that argument, and he made that argument.
Right.
I'll tell you one thing though. There was a song on here that just there's a horrible fucking song on this album, and I don't know if you guys know which one I'm talking about, but
I'm gonna guess really quick. Is it? Okay, well, I see. Well, I would ask. Okay, I'm gonna say this because
let me ask this question. Okay, is it one of the self-indulgent songs, or is it one of the rap songs? Basically,
I'll just say it's the
Electric Wire Hustler Flower.
No, it's the one with Pharrell. It's the one with Pharrell.
Oh, got a right to.
I really fucking hate that song.
Well, you know what? Spoiler style, Jonathan. I mean, I don't hate it, but if you've heard the New Danger review, I said it's giving me New Danger energy, and that's not a good thing.
It's somewhat adjacent. I mean, you know, it's Pharrell, but it's trucker hat Pharrell.
That's exactly what I was gonna say too about that song. My problems with that song are entirely have nothing to do with Common. Because I thought how he approached
the beat and all that shit was
interesting. It's classic comp.
Pharrell. Yeah, Pharrell though, that fucking hook. You could take that hook. Boom, you could take that hook. The harmonica. You could take that hook he sang and you could put that on Old Town Road.
Word. You know? I mean, this circus as a whole, obviously we're dealing with it tonight. There are some tents where it's really something going on in there. You know, bears jumping through fire hoops and it's like, oh, wow. And then other tents where it's like, this attraction hasn't been updated in like 10 years. Or like, this was an ill-advised thing. We need to cut this.
I mean, at this point.
Coming into this album, man, it's just.
We've done, you know, the first six tracks on the album. Mm-hmm. And for me personally, you know, we've gotten Soul Power and Aquarius, which are two standouts in his catalog.
I'm going to tell you right now, he's currently on track 7. He has 1, 2, 3 takeaways for me. Okay. Soul Power, Aquarius, and Come Close. So he's not in bad shape.
One either.
Oh, Come Close.
I don't hate it by any means, but my thing is I don't think Pharrell fit on this album.
He didn't. I agree.
I mean, it's not on this album, but his verse on the Come Close remix is awful, and I like him as a rapper.
I hate the Come Close remix. I don't. Yeah.
He says, "My testicles fill with ecstasy."
What? This was said?
Yes.
Oh shit.
And I mean, I've just spoke on it, but like, my issue with "Come Close," a song I do like, is that "Common" is the worst part of his own song.
He is.
And I hate when rappers are the worst part of their own song. You know, it's like. Yeah,
I was scared coming into this album because I'm like, you know, I like Come Close, but it's like, do I, when held under the you know, the magnifying glass, the microscope, is this going to be too cheesy? Is this going to clog my arteries? Am I going to be able to look past? Because, no, you know, because it's a song I remember from being a kid and I like the beat, and but it's like.
It's the Mary Bridge that seals it as like at least decent, but, you know.
Word. Yeah.
I'm not putting the takeaway on Common. So now we reach New Wave, Mel.
Right, yes. Track 7, New Wave. That's what we're discussing here right now. Featuring, it's Letitia Sadier? Sadier?
Sadier, I think.
Sadier, okay. Wherever I copied and pasted her name, they did that. What is this called? What is this like? Is this like Celtic? Where they like fuse the A and the E?
Yeah.
That means something, right? Is that Celtic? Was that right?
Man, listen, you know what I know what you mean, you know what I mean, you know?
Right, exactly. All right, yeah. Produced by James Poyser, Questlove, and J Dilla. So yeah, we're at that point in the album where we're dealing with New Wave, and we've gotten a lot of interesting stuff. We've gotten, like, if you ask me, Neo Soul, we've gotten MOP bite music, we've gotten, you know, literal circus music, like with the intro. And now we're here. And, before we get into it, I mean, we're about to give our ratings. We're gonna allow our guest, Jonathan Cloud, to see if he wants to go first or leave it to us or whatever. But I will say, anybody new here, your first time here, the rating system, we stop boring the guests by going through. They know the system, you know, for the most part. Like, Jonathan Cloud, he's been listening a long time. So if you're unfamiliar with the system, check the description of the episode. It's in the timestamps where it says the rating system explained. You press that and it'll take you right there. Or go to rapprankings.com and the FAQs. But, Jonathan, if you want to go first, if you want us to go first, however you want to do this.
Did you want me to give my background on Common?
Oh, absolutely. So, absolutely, yeah.
Okay, so. Okay, do you remember those BET video countdowns where they would have a celebrity come on and like list their 25 favorite music videos? It would just be like Bow Wow, Jermaine Dupri, just random fucking people listening to their favorite videos. Y'all remember that?
I think I remember that. Yeah. Yeah. I hope I remember it, and it's not just Moulz because he ain't black, but yeah, it's familiar. Yeah.
Yeah.
They don't scan you when you press, you know, in my case, 54.
Oh, yeah. Well, 24 here in Peoria. Yeah, I guess. Yeah, they don't scan your retinas to see if you're watching BET while not black. But yeah, continue, John.
Yeah. So I don't remember exactly who it was. I think it was someone like weird that I wouldn't have figured listen to common that shared, they had his Testify video that, so that was the first song I ever heard from Common. Huh, and okay. I forget if it was like fucking Tyrese or it was someone like random, but, huh. They put Common Testify, and I want to say this was in between B and Finding Forever. Was Finding Forever 07?
07.
I believe it. Yeah, 07.
Yeah.
Yeah, so this was like
2 or 3 months before graduation.
Hmm. Okay.
Just like, so this was like 2 or 3 months before late registration.
Okay, I gotcha. So this was about, I heard that, and that was like, because I remember riding around, because I'm from Boston. I remember riding around Boston and seeing the posters for Finding Forever and being excited for it. So, yeah, I heard Testify, and then I heard B, and yeah, I really fucked with the shit. And, you know, my first album I ever had was Roots Tipping Point. Like, okay. That's my first album I ever had.
Underrated and, album.
Oh, yeah. And
because of the Interscope shit, you know, like the Don't Say Nothings and the Duck Downs.
Yeah, I don't know if Common was on that. Was he?
Nah, he wasn't on the album.
Okay. So yeah, that was like my first album I ever had. Black album was the first I ever bought, like, with money. And yeah, I think I stole fucking Tipping Point from the library or some shit. But so yeah, that was like right in, you know, I was kind of spoiled. I had like a good start to music. Yeah. I had a good start to hip hop. So I heard that shit and I'm like, oh, this is right in my alley. Like, and it being surrounded by all the other shit on BET. So I thought I hit a fucking gold mine. But yeah, I really fucked with B and I was really excited for Finding Forever. And yeah, I ended up checking out the whole catalog. I even liked the first album, honestly. I know. Oh,
can I borrow?
I don't think Jesse. Yeah, I don't think Jesse likes that one very much.
No, we know.
I don't love it. There's a couple songs on there I enjoy, but
yeah, it begins
for me really with Resurrection.
Yeah, I understand the whole voice thing. So, but yeah, I was all in.
It's grown on me, I think. Like, it's better than I remember it. I've listened to it fairly recently.
Yeah, the beats are crazy. Yeah, I was all in on Common. And when did I hear this album? I think I avoided this album for a while because I was on message boards. I was on I hate to admit it, but I was on All Hip Hop for a while. And yeah, I don't think I ever seen anything
so
good about this
I
album.
I mentioned this in the background info, but this album got reevaluated somewhat, and it was after Dilla passed. Because essentially, yeah, what was happening was, you know, pre-B, this album was considered like Common, he's gone too soft, he's under Erykah Badu's control, which is a whole other conversation. And, you know, she's got him dressing funny. and his music got whack or this and that. It's too weird. It's too experimental, you know, and they weren't really feeling it. And then all of a sudden, and not like all of a sudden, Dilla passes. And I start seeing a lot of threads on OK Player, you know, from even Questlove, who is saying, you know, this album is so underrated. This is like the peak of our Soulquarian collaborations and production. And, you know, a lot of people were advocating for this album. Give it another spin. Focus on Dilla's work on the album. You know, don't think too much about Common. And, you know, Common undoubtedly on this album, and if we're going to really keep it a buck, like Water for Chocolate, has gone down one notch as an MC from where he was on Resurrection and One Day.
Well, you know, my thing on that, but
what's happening though is the music is a lot more, it's less almost beats and it's more like fully fleshed out arrangements.
You know,
I'm kind of in the same boat as you, Jonathan, because here's the thing, like, I'm always the guy who, when I hear that an album has like a bad reputation or something, admittedly, I almost see it as a challenge. It's like, oh, well, I gotta hear it now, you know, but like, I've been meaning to listen to this for years because I'm a Common fan. Moulz put me on a Resurrection. My journey started probably with my dad and B. Before that, he probably played like The Light and stuff around me. I think he played me like I Used to Love Her in like maybe 2005 or something like that. But yeah, B and Finding Forever were like the two Common albums for me where they were played so much in my dad's truck. And like I ripped the CD and like put them on my MP3 player and I was listening to them. So when I heard it's like, oh, he has this one album that's like, it's a weirdo album. Like it sucks. And I'm like, well, one, I'm a weirdo nigga. So I'll see about that. And number two, like I saw the cover and I'm like, oh, this is cool. This looks like some like 70s. Not that I know much about these people, but like some real Beatles.
Well, yeah,
that's Beatles.
It's kind of riffing on the Sergeant Pepper's album cover. Yeah.
Yeah. But with black people on it. And
yes, and with a comic, kind of like almost a Jimi Hendrix experience color scheme. I know you like Jimi Hendrix, Mel.
Oh, brother. Yeah, famously, the Jimi Hendrix enjoyer, as discovered in the Diplomatic Immunity Review. But no, like this cover, and I was like, yeah, you know, I want to check this out. And I had been meaning to. I understood a lot of people, like, you know, where it had its reputation. So I never avoided it, but I never quite got around to it until this week, obviously.
But was this your most anticipated album of the season, Mel?
Of this season?
Obviously stuff you hadn't heard. You're most interested in
the lineup again.
You know, figuring it out.
Probably this is up there. This could be number one. Nostradamus. Because that was another one where I heard, like, oh, this is god-awful. It's the worst thing. Right. And it wasn't to me. But, this might be number one. Because this is an artist that I like, and I'm pretty familiar with their catalog. At least until, I'll admit, I stopped checking after Universal Mind Control. That's not me commenting on Universal Mind Control, but like after that, like, was it The Dreamer, The Believer? Like, I heard the singles from that, but like,
people like that album. It's kind of everything afterwards that people have been sort of dicey on.
Yeah, you know, all that stuff. I haven't heard a common album since 2012.
What is it? Nobody's Smiling?
Yeah, what was that? Was that 2015?
I actually like that album. I would put my chips on that being probably his last good album.
You didn't like the one that Kareem Riggins produced? Black America again.
The problem, it's not Kareem Riggins. The problem is Common has gone to a new level of just like Jesse's Right, you know? Like he's rapping for Starbucks right now, you know?
Well, Jesse's wrong, but Common's making him look right. Common is a pretty
But the thing about this album is that, you know, I do feel like some of these albums that he was doing for a while very much felt like brother and sister albums. I feel like Resurrection and One Day really have a lot in common. No Idea, I think, produced both entirely. Common's rapping at, in my opinion, the highest level he ever did. Mm-hmm. Like Water for Chocolate and Electric Circus are brother and sister albums. you know, very similar production personnel. It's just that one leans a little bit more left. The other one's a little bit, you know, a mix of that and still kind of what we know him for. And then B and Finding Forever, also very similar albums.
Yeah. Yeah. For sure. You know, so coming into this, I was like, all right, it's time to hear this album that people claim is a misstep and he was on his weirdo shit. And, you know, what's the line? you know, the famous one. It's like, you know, they say the crochet pants and the sweaters was whack.
Sweater was whack. Heard the corner.
You know, and I'm like, okay, well, this is the album then, I guess, when supposedly Eric Badu had put the voodoo on him and he was wearing the crochet pants. So, yeah, I mean, this is one I've been looking forward to. Based on how it had been described to me, I will say already, I mean, we're about to be seven tracks in now. It's not quite what I expected based on how it was spoken about on message boards and in certain circles. Like, I was expecting this, like, aimless, formless, like, almost like right. ambient thing. Like, they made it sound like it was just so inaccessible.
Now, you know? Really, what it's number one, not totally without precedent, because we did get Stankonia in 2000, and the end of that album, the last two or three tracks or whatever, it gets kind of out there, right? And I feel like some of the more out there stuff on this album, which quite frankly we haven't even gotten to yet, that kind of exists in that same realm. But number one, Common has a lot less goodwill than Outkast does. And number two, you know, it's still 2002. And this is not every day. Like, bro, you got to kind of put yourself in an era. There's no Kid Cudi. There's none of this, you know, whatever shit's going on. We know about September 11th, 2007. The catastrophic, you know, effects of this date. But this ain't that time.
So you feel like this is almost like predating that. In a way. So the audience at the time we're looking at
it. Yeah, sideways. Like, bro, keep it like in your mind still that like Outkast was experimenting, but they were still making hot records. They had not put out Speaker Box Love Below yet. So, and you know, that album received accolades and great reviews and everything like that. But there are hip hop heads who are like, I don't like the singing album on there. Mm-hmm.
Or the singing songs, like, you know, so you're saying Moulz took the famous Rap Ranking Time Machine back to 2002. And, you know, well, actually, he would have assumed you were talking about the tragedy from a year before, but you would have listened to Electric Circus and told him.
That reminds me of that tragedy.
You know, but no, you mean the tragedy that had yet to happen 5 years later, Graduation versus Curtis. But, yeah, I mean, quite frankly, it seemed hip hop, you could say in a positive sense, they weren't ready.
They weren't
or
ready.
Or you could say they didn't want this shit. Like, at all. Yeah, like, this
I
is
mean,
not.
Again, because it's been reevaluated, I think it's interesting to look back on. Because, honestly, outside of the true, like, Dilla cultists, no one's calling this album a classic. There's still hip hop heads out there who don't give a shit what Dilla did.
I mean, bro, there's something I noticed too. It's because you said, and I noticed that too, because I went to the Wikipedia page and I'm like, and it said it's got acclaim. And I'm like, oh,
yeah. Sometimes what was this? You know, sometimes the what marks go in there and they edit things. You know.
Yeah, but the thing is, even still. I can't remember the last time I've heard anyone talk about this album.
Oh,
and I've heard people
I can,
talk about other Common albums.
But it's because I'm in a lot of these Dilla circles. You know, I'm at the Dilla parties. I'm around a lot of, I mean, listen, I used to call some of these people Dilla dumbasses because they were so obsessed with Dilla. And yeah, I could tell that they had no other thoughts going on in their brain other than Dilla, so I just call them Dilla dumbasses.
I'm gonna get to the whole. I think the whole reevaluating of this album is. I think there's a lot to that, but we'll get to that. get to that later.
We'll certainly get to it, but it's it's just interesting to me because I never thought this album was a classic. I've always felt like Common from Resurrection to Finding Forever was on a run of very good to great albums. Like, he never dropped an album that I personally was like, oh man, I don't like this at all.
Yeah.
So Electric Circus to me, at first, pre Dilla passing away, felt like, okay, I feel like there are actually good songs on this album, and people are just making this out to be much more, I guess, experimental than it actually is.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's not a bad album. I think it's decent. But then people took it in the whole other direction and they're like, it's a classic. It might be my favorite Common album. And I'm like, oh no. Like, they're doing that thing that they do.
The classic the thing overcorrection.
I was around for, though. I was actually present for and witnessed this thing happening.
Mm-hmm.
I remember people shitting on this thing. So does Common. He raps about it in his music around this time. You know, B and preceding, you know, 04, 05-ish. So he looks back on it lyrically. You know, this is like written testimony, as far as I'm concerned, saying people thought this shit was whack. He's not commenting and saying, I think it's whack. He's saying the people thought that, which is true. So it's crazy now that some of these people are like, nah, this is my favorite Common album. It's his best. Dilla snapped. And I'm just like, bro, Dilla is great, but he can't save this whole fucking album. There's some missteps on here for sure. He got too free. At this point in the album, I've only skipped one song, that electric wire shit with the dude from POD.
Okay.
I like every other song we've heard thus far to varying degrees. But do you want to rate this thing? Do you want to rate New Wave?
Oh, sure.
I want to say I give it 8-.
Okay.
All right, get this. Check this out, okay? Moulz and John connect. Wait, no, hold on. I like this better. Moulz and Cloud connect.
Yeah, phonetically, it has some flavor to it. All right. Moulz and Cloud connect, sure.
8-. This is another setup. Highlight for me. Another highlight. It's, you know, Soul Power, Aquarius, New Wave, and there's one more coming up for me.
I feel like sometimes Moulz waits for the guests to show up and to give their rating, so then he could do this thing where he tethers himself to them to make Mel look bad. Okay,
Mel, now I sent you my ratings of this album days ago already. All right, this song has always been an 8-.
Fair enough. Fair enough. Well, I give it's it a tied 7+. Is, 7+. Okay.
Listen, look at that fucking Russo swerve over there with making it seem like he wasn't going to like the song.
Well, I mean, you know, it's still right underneath. So it's like, oh, look at this asshole over here. He doesn't want to give it an 8. It's like, look.
Well, listen, it's your first week with New Wave, which I'm sure Jonathan and I could, we have had much more time with it than you.
True, true.
It's not Mel 7-. If it was a 6 or a 7-, I mean, we'd be raking you over the coals right now, confirmed. But, you know, I can't hate on you for that rating.
Yeah, I mean, listen, with time, you know, hopefully I can get like Cloud and Moulz one day and really get into this album. I can see this going up to an 8 because, I mean, just off the top, I know why I'm here. I'm here for this beat.
I'm so here for this beat, and I'm here for this chorus. I've always been intrigued by it. It's vaguely French. It's definitely French. Some of the cadences sound distinctly French, actually. But there's it sounds like a 60s French pop song almost.
Wow!
Have you guys ever heard Stereolab?
Oh, I've heard some Stereolab. Yeah, it's kind of in
I've heard
vein.
A few songs.
Is she from Stereolab?
I believe she's the lead singer.
Let me
make sure.
Yeah,
just,
she is. Okay.
She is. Yeah.
Okay, wow. Mel, you would definitely dig Stereolab when you're in your, like, quiet time moments. You know what I mean? Like, in your kind of halfway ambient style, but also kind of like, you know, electronic.
Okay.
You would dig it.
Alright. You know, Dilla actually sampled Stereolab. I don't know if it was before this or after this, but one of his more notable records. I can't remember exactly which, and I probably shouldn't even say which, but yeah.
But listen, I've been on record on this show many times fighting back against the new age bullshit, but I'm fine with the new wave bullshit, okay? And I gotta say, yes, Common is rapping a notch below where he was on the last time we reviewed him with Resurrection, but he drops a couple bars specifically in the second verse that I've always really enjoyed, like, in a room called real, I stay forever.
That's a bar. That's a bar.
Every day I lose something, I gain forever.
See, it's lines like that. Okay, Moulz Mel connect, because I like those lines, you know, but, you know, the Jessies of the world would be like, oh, that ain't good rapping, you know? Stuff like in verse one, shit is so hot that the sun watch, he'd be like, oh my God, like, y'all say this is the GOAT MC. It's like, well, one, we didn't say it was the GOAT MC, but two, you're trying to act like this man is not
never
a
good said
rapper,
he was the GOAT MC. All I ever said was Resurrection is my highest rated hip hop album as far as I know.
Right.
And he could be the worst rapper of all time, and I could still be saying that.
It's a holistic experience. It's beats and rhymes. Okay. You know, those things, they mesh and they form something new, you know? So it's, yeah, I mean, there are bars here. Verse three is actually my favorite verse.
Same here.
Verse three is very good, yeah, too. Verse one, yeah. I'm a little, that's where my minus comes from on this song. Love the beat, okay. Really like the chorus. Verse two and three are great. Verse one, he has a fascination with these monkeys on stage and stuff. You know what I'm talking about?
Monkeys dance around for MTV spots.
Yeah, he does it on Start the Show on Finding Forever also, and some people believe it's a 50 Cent diss, which... If this bald freak really wanted to diss 50 Cent, I would watch out if I were him. That's
your G-Unit soldier is showing. Okay. He's not a bald freak, but I will say, I'm going to throw him a bone here. At least on this album, we're at the circus, you know, the flying.
Oh, monkey, right. Okay. I'm happy with that then.
There we go. You know,
What? Fuck it. I'm pro monkey.
Whoa. Okay. Please nobody clip that and make it sound like bad faith Moulz, okay? I mean, although if you clipped it, it would be not racist, but the language itself would still be questionable. Wow, like breaking news, Moulz is pro monkey. After that is a little bit of sound effect flair.
Listen, all that's gonna do is end in a tearful meeting with D-Ray where we eventually get a sick photo op together and we all move on.
Brother. Is he still doing stuff? I don't know. I mean, if he's still wearing that that vest.
Oh, you know he is.
I don't know, man.
It's like he's an upgraded version, like Spider-Man upgrades his outfit.
Okay. At least there's enough.
Listen, I feel like you open up his closet and it's like Doug.
Right. Dear journal. Okay. Yeah. He's got the dog going on. I mean, to be fair, it's not an ugly vest. It just feels like, damn, like you really had to turn yourself into a cartoon. Brand recognition, I guess.
Yeah. But, listen, me and Vince Russo are going to sit with him and discuss with him the fact that Planet of the Apes is a beloved franchise and don't nobody trying to be doing nothing moment. With them apes. Okay.
That moment. Yeah. With the,
ain't no apes.
You know, to be fair, though, because I was unfamiliar with the lore like that, I thought he had a point. When you brought that up, it's like, oh, wow, like they put this monkey on the cover of like the, it wasn't the first reboot. It was like the sequel or whatever.
It was,
like,
yeah, but he's always had the blue vest since from
exactly. And I didn't know. And somebody pointed out, I'm like, okay, well, yeah, D-Ray might have been a reach. It's a fair reach, if you ask me. But
it's
was a like,
fair reach, and he made up for it with his Taco Bell tweet. So you know,
word. Okay, well, yeah, the innovation in menu design tweet, classic tweet. But Yeah, I mean, this is definitely common when he's on that money. This album, I mean, it continues into being Finding Forever, but it's this sort of like, you know, the real MCs versus the fake MCs thing. And yeah, mileage can vary on that. But I think Common, for the most part, toes this line where he makes it sound cool to want to be on the side of the, quote, real MCs.
I mean, the new wave, like pushing things right forward, you know?
You know, so
Jonathan, like, was talking about the Finding Forever promo posters you saw in Boston.
Yeah.
When that album cover came out, I think they actually premiered the cover on OKP, maybe even in the forums. But that cover got roasted to high heaven, and I thought they were going to change it. And I'm thinking to myself, like, yo, this is like some fucking Yoda shit. Like, what is going on? I've never seen anything like this.
Did you see the remake with what's the name from The Wire? Where they photoshopped the old dude from The Wire?
Oh, into the Finding Forever?
Yeah.
It was kind of early meme. Like, people were really roasting this cover, dude.
Wow. Yeah, they did the same shit with Below the Heavens.
Really? Well, see, that makes sense to me, because that's kind of like has those Photoshop-y elements that it's like, okay, like, what are we doing here? I mean, I'll chalk this up to me being young and not being on those message boards at the time when this album came out. I never thought anything of the Finding Forever cover other than it not looking like a rap album cover. Like, it looks like something you would sell in a Starbucks. Oh, man.
They were shitting on this cover. And, like, the crazy, like, you know, mid-2000s graphic design going on the side.
Yeah, it's very graphic design. That was the worst thing I could say about it. I mean, compared to B, which looks instantly vintage. It's like the, you know, the newsboy cap and the, you know, that looks hip-hop. This looks like, all right, bro. You know? But, I mean, I like that album. But whenever we do Finding Forever, I'll get to be a Finding Forever apologist. But, yeah, this record, what instantly caught me was the beat. And, you know, not to make this about, because, you know, it's always a risk of, you know, whenever Dilla produces anything, and falling into a conversation about Dilla. But, you know, not to make this about Dilla, but this beat came on. We talked about this when we did the Anarchy review, probably reviews before that. But this, to me, is one of them truck beats, one of them Dilla truck beats. The way I was snapping my head, the way it bangs, I just picture.
Right, you've got the electricity to it, you know, right, that.
You gotta not.
And then that.
You know? Yeah. Very like cartoon capers going on. Like we're getting
it's
into
that sound at the beginning. That's like,
you know, yeah. So I knew I was on board from that moment. It's like, all right, it's Common song to mess up at this point because the beats got me. I'm nodding, my neck is snapping, and luckily he came through. Now, what's interesting about this hook? At first, I'm like, oh man, is the energy ruined? But then, you know, with repeated listens, I'm like, no, the energy isn't ruined. What this is, which is kind of cool, is like, you know, it's almost like the mischief that I'm getting from the beat dissipates during the chorus. You know that, not to be one of these fucking people, but you know, it's like a film, bro. The scene in the final, I guess it wasn't the final Matrix now. The original final Matrix where like they're in the fucking, the real world and they go above the clouds and you see the sun for like a little bit and then they fall back into like dystopia. That's what this hook is to me. It's like the sun is shining and you got this Letitia lady singing and it's like very cheery. It's almost like some foreign exchange shit in a way. Like,
yeah, it sounds like French. Oh, you mean foreign exchange like the Fontaine and Nicolet.
Oh, yeah, Fontaine and Nicolet, yeah. Redacted way, as you have to say. But
yes.
Yeah. Yeah, and then we...
I still don't know what she's saying all the way. It's like...
It sounds good, you know?
It's like something, reality. It's a new wave. Come on. I like what Common adds.
I know what Common's saying. I mean, I read the lyrics and I'm like, yeah, I don't hear her saying this at all. But, you know, it sounds good melodically, vocally, so it works. And yeah. I like that added, that gear shift before we descend back into. It's cool. It feels like a circus in a good way. You know, like it's a lot of different stuff flying around and happening and everybody holds it down. Common's rapping, Letitia's singing. this could very well be an eight one day.
I feel like this and I Am Music with Jill Scott coming up later on are the two songs that feel like Electric Circus to me the most. Right.
Especially I Am Music, and we'll explain when we get there. But I was getting a certain song on Idlewild from that one.
Okay.
You know which one I'm talking about, most likely. But yeah, I mean, this album works best when, like, I know the point of the album wasn't so much the circus of it all. Like, I'm sure Common didn't show up in like a freaking circus get up and it's like, all right, y'all, we making this circus album. He's got a monkey like doing flips.
It was
on
really
his
more electric than
right
circus,
than circus.
You know.
But there are moments like this where I feel the circus, and later on when I feel the circus, but. It's songs like this where it makes me think, okay, people just, they weren't ready, you know, I mean, at the time I would have been nine. Okay. And I wasn't, you know, Jonathan, you said your first album was, the Roots album. My first album was, the Now 4 compilation. So I don't think I've got, what's that?
I had one of the Nows. I had the
okay,
one with,
okay.
I think that was like my second or third.
You're saying it's your first album of all time. Like, ever, or you're
I wouldn't
or,
count
like,
it as an album. I
because,
wouldn't count
like,
it as an album.
Like, are we counting like the Aladdin soundtrack, the Home Alone 2 soundtrack? Like, where are we going with this? You know,
technically, it would have been. Let me see. Oh, hold on a second. Now, four. When did that come out? It actually wouldn't have been. It's the first one that I personally requested. Like, I saw it at the mall. I think it might have been Sam Goody. And I'm like, the cover, it was like a snowflake on it. And I'm like, oh, this is cool. This is icy. I want this. Or like, it was blue. And like, I looked at the back and I'm like, I know all these songs. You know, I was like, I want this. And someone got it for me. But actually, technically, the first album I was ever given would have had to have been probably Big Willie Style. My dad gave it to me after spring break. I had it on cassette. But like, this is the first album that I remember wanting and requesting.
Okay.
The first rap album I ever got. Weirdly enough that I like wanted, you know, I actually don't remember that, because nobody would have bought it for me. I would have had to buy it myself because my dad ain't want me listening to all that cussing, you know. But like, yeah, it could have been shit. It could have been Born to Rain again, Will Smith.
But Moulz,
anyway,
Moulz, you said you had the Chingy Jackpot album, right?
Yeah, but that was by far not my first album. I mean, I was many albums deep at that point.
Yeah, I got to confess, I had the
the Jackpot. Second.
No, I was a fan, but I didn't buy any of his albums. I had the second Dem Franchise Boys album.
Second Dem Franchise Boys album.
Yep. I don't even remember what the fuck it was called, but it had some with Jim Jones on it. And, yeah.
Let me see. If this is the one I'm thinking of, let me see. Is it On Top of Our Game?
Yeah.
Okay. I think
are they in a car?
Me, Lean With It,
yes,
Rock With
yes.
It.
Okay. Yeah, I remember this album. What the hell was their first album if those are the songs on the second one, though?
White T wasn't on that.
Right. White T. Yeah. Yeah, that was the first album. Okay.
Man, Dark Days.
Who am I thinking of that made, because it wasn't apparently the franchise, Party Like a Rock Star. Who was that?
Shop Boys.
Shop. Okay. Shop Boys. Yeah. That was, oh my, totally, dude. Listen, going to a fucking private Catholic school, them whites was going crazy.
I'm not a party like, you know, I love Black Boy, White Boy, Black Boy, White Boy. I love that.
Right.
I don't fuck with the Shop Boys. I never cared for the song.
It was a guilty play. I probably won't like it anymore, but at the time, you know, it's like, you know, you had to like it, but. Yeah, this is you know, sorry, remember where how I got on this? What I was talking about, our first
albums.
Yeah, we review, right, rap. What do we do with Rap Ranking? We review albums, right? Anyway, back to Common. He has a way of making what could be looked at as head ass or dusty, or it's like, okay, here we go, rapping about rap. When it comes from him, I get swept up in the cause. It's like, you know, when he's like seeing hype become fame against the grain, become mainstream, it all seems mundane in the scope of things. Maybe it's my proximity to having been a rapper and having been in the industry. Cause I mean, I rock with those lines before I ever started rapping in 2007, but like, he really makes it seem like, take up your arms. We got to do this like preservation of the culture, y'all, of hip hop, and keep MCing pure. Where, you know, in a lesser rapper's hands, it's like, oh, brother, okay. You know, but like,
I think he has a very positive like approach with it. Like, he's not, you know, he's you know, he's talking about whack rappers and shit and, you know, bullshit, but he's not doing it in a way that's abrasive. Like,
yeah, he doesn't really beat you over the head with it like you know, another rapper would.
Yeah, like I would.
Yeah. It's just, you know, like he makes me want to be a good MC rather than berate the bad ones. And I think that's the mark of getting that message across in a effective way. You know,
Jesse's, if you want to go out and be the change. Rolling his eyes right now, okay?
Oh, we know about Jesse. He's trembling.
He's stomping his feet. Okay. He's punching his Chloe Bailey custom punching bag.
Oh, you fucking know about Jesse. Okay. His bizarre obsession with Chloe Bailey and her sexuality and how it's apparently not on time, or it's fake and it's manufactured and it's not working. Listen, nigga, you old, nigga. We all old. Gotta concern yourself with other things, okay? And listen, he's really gonna hate this. Jesse, you gonna tell me this is bad rap? From Atlanta, shit talk, porn stars, and pitchforks. Didn't really see white until I went north, getting bent off in backyards, wishing in the air for a black guy. Okay, this is imagery. This is language. I walked through the black fog with reflectors on my boots, smelling war near. I'm connected with the troops, okay? That Master Anger ain't afraid to shoot through poor liquor, fallen angels, they salute, okay? Where was you at, Jesse, when it started out in the park, okay? I was there, all right? I was there when hip-hop started out in the park. They said, Mel, there's no record of you being there. Well, I was in the cut, all right? I was under, like, a tree. I was peeking around. I was a lot of adults there, so I didn't want to, you know, get nobody away. They say you stay out of grown folks' business, but I was peeking around the tree, and I'm like, man, this hip-hop is a good thing. Jesse wasn't there. He was at home, probably. Who was the over-sexualized teen of the day when hip-hop started, okay?
When hip-hop started? He was sitting on the
stoop. Yeah. The Chloe Bailey of the, you know, early 70s.
Who were the over-sexualized women of the 1970s?
Yeah, I it's probably not readily available information, but
hold on. This is why we listen. This is why we got to go with them fucking boys, them fucking AIs, you know?
Hold on. Let's see. Bing. Led Zeppelin guitarist Jimmy Page slept with groupie Lori Maddox shortly after David Bowie took her virginity at 15. So Jesse was probably shaming this poor girl who was clearly preyed upon and groomed.
She wasn't a famous person.
No, hold she was on, famous. She's in a picture with the Led Zeppelin guitar. He was like, man, that Lori Madonna. Maddow, okay?
It'd be Madonna.
Madonna?
Debbie Harry.
In the early 70s?
Yeah, Debbie Harry. Farrah Fawcett.
I know Jack A. Harry. Okay.
Bette Midler. Oh, it's important to remember these women were more than just their sexuality, and their impact on popular culture extended beyond their perceived sexual expression.
Oh, brother. He's gonna hate us for this. Jesse, you just give us the ammo, bro. We gotta load it in the gun and fire it. I'm sorry, but yeah, I mean, this makes me feel the spirit of hip hop. This often happens when common raps, and less in recent years, absolutely. But from the time I discovered him, I would say from like 2000 to 2013, he was a guy who really made me feel that in a pure sense, and it didn't feel dorky. You know,
I found this information here about Chloe Bailey, Mel.
Oh, what did you find?
I put it in the chat style.
What is this, chat GPT information?
No, it's Bing. Bing GPT. Bing Chloe has an Bailey, AI search.
Everyone, Snapchat does now. I got a freaking email from Google Docs or something. It's like the AI tools. Like, I don't want to talk to these robots. Okay, I'm fine. I'm good. All right. I feel like they, I want to talk to these robots. I'm fine. I feel like, yeah, that would have been a fire Chappelle show skit, I'm sure, AI. But anyway, Chloe Bailey is a singer, songwriter, and actress known for her work as part of the R&B duo Chloe and Haley. She has gained a significant following for her talent and artistry. Wow.
You hear that, Jesse? Her talent and artistry. It doesn't say anything about sex appeal. You're grafting that onto her.
You're the one fixated on her and her burgeoning sexuality. Listen, she's a grown-ass woman. She can do what she wants to do. Okay? Anyway.
I'm a fan of her talent and artistry, mainly.
Okay. Well, listen, but does, I mean,
she,
I'm,
does she have sex appeal? Yeah, I think people want to have sex with her.
No, brother. Well, I mean, see, now you're getting into a territory where it's like, I mean, we know about men. We'll have sex with anything for the most part, you know?
Yeah, so why is she, so what, is she the only person people don't want to have sex with? That's what he's making it out to be.
Right, but we know about him. It's ridiculous. But he himself admitted on the show, on the Love Movement Review, I believe, where he's like, yeah, you know, I'd do it. But it's like, yeah, exactly. Just stop there, okay, Jesse? We know about you. But anyway... We
won't stop till he apologizes, here, right? And we need some apologin from the third member.
Oh, apologin, huh? Yeah.
We got archival audio. I brought archival audio in so we could hear the sample, but Jonathan Cloud has brought in archival audio as well.
Is he, maybe not the first guest, because I mean, Jesse brings in stuff, but yeah. Jesse's the third member. Is he the first guest to bring in archival? I feel like that could be true.
I need to.
I have stuff for the other episode, not the other episode that me and Moulz talked about. Not the Hell Hath No Fury one, but the other one. Like I have some shit for that.
Oh, he's prepared. He's prepared. Well, I'm giving it to him. The first guest to bring our
the first, the first guy. All right.
You know.
Meanwhile, the real first guy is just sitting there right now, listening.
He'll be fine. He'll be fine.
He'll be fine, exactly. Okay, tell him. But yeah, we got some archival from both Moulz and Jonathan Cloud. What are we starting with? What is this? What did you send me here, Moulz? You only sent me one thing.
It's the sample.
The sample. Okay, Dream Suite, apparently, is the name of this.
Yeah, by Dreams, right?
Let me or see. Dream? By Dreams. Yeah, I guess so.
By Dreams. Dream Suite.
Okay. Are these is the people long. That made that
Is this long? This is long, long, right? Is it long or is it flack?
15 minutes and 21 seconds.
Yeah, so listen, we'll listen in a little bit and then we'll turn it off. You know, we're not listening to that shit.
All right, here we go.
Check where you're going, 'cause you may
There's a little bit of it. I mean, I'm guessing the part that was probably deeper into the 15 minutes on.
It's somewhere in the middle.
Okay, got it. Well, that's that. Listen, when you digging in them crates and you looking for records, okay, don't be like an early beat making Mel, and you know hear the first 30 seconds of something and be like, oh, off to FL Studio. Like you listen.
Actually, just a small portion of this beat is indebted to the sample. A majority of the music that you're hearing is original.
Is that right? Yeah. Well, they was in that studio being soul quarians and filling the vibes. Okay.
So. I don't know. This particular beat feels like a lot of the shit that was on Dilla tapes around this time. So I feel like
a lot of the synth work too.
Yeah. I feel like a lot of this beat was just mostly, if not entirely, Dilla.
Word.
That kind of like rawr, 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 that's the only sound from the sample.
Got it.
The boom, okay. Boom, 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 that's not from the sample.
Nice.
Neither is the chorus. So there's original stuff happening here.
Well, speaking of that man again, Dilla, we got some stuff that Jonathan Quayle brought in here.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Let's see what we got. The giant bag of archivo goodies, you know. All right, we got some Electric Circus outtakes instrumentals, and we got a Common and Dilla unreleased snippet, apparently between like Water for Chocolate or Electric Circus, might be the Electric Circus sessions.
Okay,
yeah, let's start with that. I'm interested. Let's see.
What's it called?
It just says Common Dilla snippet.
Oh,
okay. You know, so right. Let's see.
Yeah, we rush it. 1, 2, check. Yeah, it all started with Port Amigo. The fruit of Islam and Insult. It took the city of Shy. Let me your eye pitch the skyline. Young studs of Bot Dimes. Souls of Black Folk. Wrapped in the words that I rhyme. I line myself with teachers, ice hustlers, and thugs. We from the same vein. We bleed the same blood type. C-H-I-C-A-G-O. I recognize a nigga from the crib wherever we go. So some don't comprehend the constant wind that blows in. The theory on the low end. Don't go to Jax, but you don't know, man. High blocks and cold, man.
You know, hearing that, in a way, it sounds like what the album would be without the electric in it.
Yeah. Like, I mean, that sounds definitely like a Like Water for Chocolate song or something that before they started shaping this album into what it ended up being.
Right. And so this
Common, you know, even sounds like more like 2000 Common, like how he sounds on The Light and Sixth Sense and those singles and everything.
Right. Yeah. Cause this beat specifically, and a few other songs on here, it's almost like this beat particularly was obviously the next evolution of what Dilla was, the direction he was going, which is why it's, a lot of people don't really talk about the electronic, like, era that Dilla was on. Like I see a lot of praise for like the tribe shit, the donut shit, but not really. I don't really see a lot of people
MCA
reference
era.
Yeah,
and, you know, the original, like, that shit was great. Rough Draft, you know.
I see people talk about that shit, but I'm talking about like the
beat tapes.
Yeah, like the just the more electronic shit. Like, have you heard Busta Rhymes Make It Hurt?
Oh, of course.
Like that type
all
of
the,
shit. That
all
type
the Busta albums.
I forget what
oddly
album
enough,
was on.
Like up until I think Year of the Dragon, they all had Dilla beats, sometimes multiples on them. So yeah. You know, if you're a Dilla mark, you were going through everything.
Yeah. I never heard anyone really reference like that. It's almost like that. I don't know if people have an aversion to that type of music and they like the more, like, you know, the more traditional shit.
It's not about that, honestly. It's not the fact that they have an aversion. I never hear them talk about Welcome to Detroit. I mean, really, just the it's weird because like the Donuts era, you could say like kicks off after J-Lib.
Yeah,
when he's around Mad Lib and he's.
Yeah, I don't even think Donuts was. I said I don't even think some of his best shit like around that time wasn't even on Donuts. Like I'm like 05.
Well, Donuts was him doing the Motown style or whatever he was trying to say it was called. Like kind of influenced by Mad Lib. Like let me make some kind of Mad Lib esque beats. This is already his fifth or sixth iteration of let me do something. But the Detroit electronic. You know, era, oddly enough, you know, you look at Black Milk, that's clearly the stuff that, like, he's most inspired by in Dilla's catalog.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's probably just for a lot of people, you know, who came to him after his passing, which, you know, is understandable. Perhaps the surface level appreciation or like never actually past it's like Doom or whatever. Lack of familiarity more so.
With Doom, it's MF Doom, Operation Doomsday, Food and Mad Villainy and maybe Danger Doom. And that's it. Like they're not doing King Ghidorah. They're not doing the two Victor Vaughn albums. Like there's so much that gets skipped over in that surface level appreciation.
It's just, it's just weird to me that, it's weird to me when people are very rabid, like very like intense about, you know, their appreciation. But how can you really be intense about a surface level appreciation? I don't understand that.
Because it's always, you know, if you really want to get into the psychology of it, it's like, why is Urban Outfitters selling vinyl right next to a bunch of frames that perfectly fit vinyl? Because people like album artwork. And, you know,
it's the
they may not even have the means to play it. It's, that's really what it is. It's like, you know, they want to
the
really skim the surface
and
be mini, you know, experts in a way. Because what you see, for example, is through Doom, people get into Mad Lib and then they get into this person or that person. And they go through the whole tree of influences and associated acts, but they'll grab, like, one project from them. You know, nobody's actually doing, from what I can see, any actual music appreciation more than they're just putting together grids of album covers next to each other and putting albums up on their wall. And like, hey, if that's gonna put money in the pocket of the artist, and that's how, you know, I'm seeing it right now, for instance, with Blu-rays, because I'm a film collector and, you know, I'm a film collector. So a lot of times movies get repackaged in fancy editions and I'm not necessarily compelled to upgrade because I already have the movie. But, you know, sometimes people will buy a movie 3, 4, 5 different times over the course of, you know, 15 or 20 years. And, you know, a lot of it is people buying shit because it's like, oh, limited edition, or it's Criterion, or it's, oh, this comes with a slip cover or a limited box or whatever. And, you know, there's people who I really think they're like, you know, they're shelf whores. They're like, you know, what they call like shelf porn. They'll put up pictures on the boutique Blu-ray Reddit subreddit, you know, of all the new things that they bought. It's, I don't know, it's like a community that's kind of fueled by the consumption of things rather than, and the consumption meaning spending, rather than the actual, like, are you guys watching any of the movies that you're buying? Or are you buying them and putting them on your shelf because they're limited? And, you know, you have such a surface level appreciation of these things because you're caught in this, like, almost, you know, consumerist hamster wheel that you're in. So there's an element of that, too. It's like, how many times is Stone's Throw going to repackage Mad Villainy and Donuts into, you know, oh, a 7-inch box, this, that,
oh, that's a whole other, that's a whole other thing. I'm sure you've seen some of the bullshit.
Oh, some of the bullshit
surrounding Peanut Butter Wolf, but yeah.
And Egon and everything else that's been going on with Doom as well. But, and Dilla, you know, as somewhat documented at points in the Dilla Time book. But, you know, the fact is, there's people who are really consumers first and foremost, and then there's people who are appreciators first and foremost. And I think our show specifically caters to the appreciators, because people who have a very surface level appreciation of mad villainy are quite frankly not going to have the stamina to sit through an 8.5-9 hour review of that album, because they just want to post the cover and hopefully more press photos emerge of Doom and Madlib together that they can like post up favorite duos, you know, quote tweet with your answer. There's very little actual, you know, I think Dart Adams was just talking about this, of all these quote unquote hip hop Twitter accounts, very little actual value is being added to the space. A lot of it is really just the same conversations, the same questions over and over again, the same albums, the same artists, the same covers, and it's all, you know, very much just regurgitated, oftentimes incorrect, inaccurate information.
People want to post the Mad Villainy cover in quote accordion for the 18,000th time. I know how it goes. You know, it's like...
Yeah, I understand it. I do understand it, but at the same time, it's like y'all miss out on good Dilla shit. Like, really, he has a lot of like incredible shit underneath the surface.
This is what it is for me too. Like, when someone passes away, there is no more of their music. It's only what was made while they were alive. So you gotta really like. You know, if you really like this stuff, it's a lifelong hunt for new stuff that you've never heard. And, you know, we've already, just by design, have separated the wheat from the chaff with this show. So I know everybody listening right now on what is likely, you know, hour 6 or 7 of a common review would understand, you know, what we're getting at here. So we're kind of preaching to the choir, but we do have these unreleased common Electric Circus rough drafts that, you know, obviously they don't have any vocals on them, but they were beats from the Electric Circus sessions, originally leaked by Questlove on the OK Player message boards. I remember downloading these at the time, realizing they didn't have any vocals on them, and he didn't bill them as instrumentals. He literally just put EC roughs in the file, and that was it. So I'm thinking, oh shit, unreleased common from Electric Circus. I download it. It's a bunch of beats, and I'm just like, man, Questlove, gay cock and off and young. Okay.
Well, I got them loaded here. This first one now, is this supposed to be Salma Hayek? It says Selma Hijack. The Selma Hijack show is how it's spelled. But it looks close to Selma Hayek, who is an incredible woman. And now that I'm 30, I feel like I'm within the range of someone she should consider, you know?
We saw that picture you just put up, Mel. Okay.
I'm a grown ass man with a grown man body, dad bod, brother. Okay. I got, listen, she smelled a pheromones. You smell those, right? They're sniffable, or you sense them, taste them. Anyway, this is the Selma Hijack show. Okay. Here you go.
Hey, what you wanna? 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 Hey, what you wan
You know, I think that was definitely them messing around in the studio, just saying things through the vocoder. I think it's supposed to be Salma Hayek. Okay, yeah, and we know they're Salma horny, man. Hayek. They're horny as fuck.
Do you wanna?
Yeah. Okay, come
That's
on.
That's what I was hearing.
Questlove, Common. Yeah, these are horny early 2000s men. All right. I mean, she's still in her prime now, if you ask me. But I mean, listen, what is she? 56. Okay. In 2002. Okay.
She was 35. She'd be younger than I am now.
You know what I'm saying? Okay, but anyway.
Common was trying to do some things that Jaguar Wright saw.
Oh, man. All right. Okay. I like that beat. I like that beat for the record. I would be tapping my foot to that.
This was the era where she saw it, Mel. We can't avoid the situation at hand.
No, I'm not avoiding it. I'm just saying, listen, man. All right. The best of love to that woman, of course. Let's move on here. Let me see. How about this one? This is called The Electric Circus. So maybe this could have been a title track, or maybe it's what kicked it all off. Who knows? But we're going to hear it now. Here we go.
Oh, this Prince.
Isn't this like a stinger on the album or something? I feel like they played like before like one of the songs drops or at the end of one of the songs.
Is it one of the bonus beats at the end of one of the songs? I don't recall.
I think so. This is very familiar. Like, I just heard this, I feel like, this week. I'm pretty sure this gets played on the album at some point.
It might be a full version of that.
Right. Yeah, this is definitely Questlove. You know, he's a Prince mark.
That drum programming is so Prince.
Yep. Oh, absolutely. I mean, hey, little known fact, Prince was also a Salma Hayek fan. Okay. I told Moulz about this. He has a song called Valentina, okay, where it's about her. It's him singing to Salma Hayek's child to run and get their mama because Prince wanted to do stuff to her. Okay, good record. It's like an 8. But anyway.
Prince worked on the album, correct?
On
this one.
Electric Circus?
Yeah, I believe so.
Prince?
Yeah, I think he did something on one of the was it like one of the long records at the end? Jimmy Was a Rock Star, maybe?
Let me see.
Star 69. Star
personnel
69.
Section on Yeah, it says he did guitar and keyboard. Oh, you said Star 69?
Yeah.
That makes sense. That's a very Prince record. In like concept. Oh yeah, so you did guitar and keyboard. Well, would you look at that? Okay. That's shout out to Prince, man. Shout out to Prince, obviously a legend. Love that guy. But
wow.
Yeah.
What a brave thought.
That was what I was trying to get at. I know it's not revolutionary to love Prince. Okay. You see what I did there? You see the Prince and the Revolution? Okay. Anyway, you move on. We got what else?
In a revolution.
Sorry, folks, I was interrupted. My grandfather wanted to know if the Lakers won. No, they did not, because they're going to suffer as long. Like, it's like the color purple, folks. Is what old girl say, Seeley? Okay, until you do right by me. They got LeBron, and now they're cursed because he's a GM and he throws his weight around. And he's not a serious person. Okay, and listen,
fuck that guy. Okay, he was my hero, but he fucked up everything one night because he wanted to go hang out with 2 Chainz, and it's never been the same since. All right.
Yeah.
Sometimes people make one choice in their life that throws every other thing off in the future, and he made one of those choices that night.
Yeah, well, I mean, that album was not good, but...
It was the worst 2 Chainz album I ever heard.
The LeBron one?
Yeah.
The LeBron one.
In the league.
And 2 Chainz never put out another album on the level of his albums before that ever again.
That Static Selecta album might have redeemed him, because that song they put out was...
They put out a whole album?
No, they were working on a whole album, but that,
You're saying it might redeem him in the future.
Yeah.
I don't think it's coming out.
Well, it's not coming out because he's cursed from that night.
Well, LeBron heard it and he was like, yeah, we don't need that one out. You know, he was doing his fucking LeBron moves, all right? Anyway, what we got? This one we got. This is called Sofo Row. Step into the row.
What kind of rap speak? Yeah, what in the hell? I want royalties.
Yeah, Sofo Row. All right, here we go.
On Jackman.
Probably not. Although speaking of Static Selecta, Jack Harlow has worked with him. So
have I. I got to join with him.
Nice. You hear that, folks? Okay. This is a man, you better show him some respect. A legend in the building. Okay. Yeah. But Jackman coming out this Friday.
Well, it's out by the time they hear this, actually.
Oh, yeah, right. It is out. Yeah.
We now know if he was wise to do this, and it's raw, and he's now going to be taken seriously as a rapper, and this is his, like, Mac Miller faces, Mac Miller watching movies moment.
Watching movies, yeah, probably. Yeah, but...
Or is this going to be, you know, him putting out basically just another album, but he took his shirt off for no good reason.
Well, you know why he did it, okay? You gonna make me bring the drop in. This man, all this hip-hop he's been subject to, he should know the plays, okay? Where's the drop? This is... Come on. You know why he took his shirt off on the cover. 50 Cent, take it away.
This for the bitches, nigga. Bitches, nigga.
Okay?
I don't think that's not for the... I feel like Call Me... When the Kids Got Lost or something is the one with That's for the Bitches. It's like him in like the hoodie, like sitting on the stool, like, hey girl.
He looked lobotomized on that cover. No, I think the one before that, That's What They All Say. That was for the bitches. He's in the limo.
Oh, that's
He's
what
got,
they all say.
You know? Yeah.
Yeah.
I think a Brandy rap album would be great.
Hey man, I think
that's what we need. That's what we need.
Was that Ray J's sister?
Yeah. Listen, at least Jack learned, okay? At least he learned, all right?
We'll find out today.
Right, exactly. But, yeah, all right, we got the final outtake beat here, okay? I've heard some good beats in these outtakes. Some of them should have replaced Get That Pharrell Song out of here, okay? You know, we could add some good
music. My all car, the way smoking my shit.
Right. You know, come on, man. All right, this is The Dark by Common.
You know, like the light?
Wow, man, they could be connected. I don't know, that's a good point. All right, here we go.
Oh, this is gonna be the light part two, The Dark! Oh, there are times where you'll need someone. I won't be by your side.
Oh, that's
good. Because there is the dark. The dark. Let it envelop you. And DMX is going to be on here.
Right, right. Dark Man X.
Oh, there is a dark.
What?
A dark apologize.
Oh my god.
For you.
I like this beat.
Rock, rock, y'all. Yeah, it's Common Sense and DMX. We're doing it for hip hop, y'all.
Sounds like you were doing it for like fucking nu metal.
But, well, it was 2002. Yeah. We were still, you know, getting those bodies hit the floor time, you know?
Right. All right. Well, yeah, that collection of beats. What?
I just got a cursed image in my mind.
A cursed image?
Common doesn't do B, but he does jump on, like, he keeps going with this electric shit, and he jumps on a remix of Drowning Pool, Let the Bodies Hit the Floor in 2002.
Oh, man. I hate that I can hear it, and it sounds valid in the sense that, like,
it sounds bad to me. Like, on. I'm hearing it right in my head, and it's, I don't like it, but I've now heard it.
Yo, let the bodies hit the floor, Joe. Yeah. You know what? Yeah, man. All right, don't hold give on. Him any ideas. Don't give
hold
him
on.
Any
hold on. Common, get that time machine, man.
Oh, my God. No, we don't need that time. Well, I don't know. For all we know, maybe we do need that timeline, you know? Things haven't been amazing since then. So, Common, take the time machine. See what you can do. But, yeah.
I can see Common dressed like Jeff Hardy in the video, too.
Why not? You know, why not? Anyway. Folks, Common, okay? Electric Circus. New Wave.
Jonathan Cloud.
Jonathan Cloud, yes, most sir. Importantly. Okay. Well, I mean, hey, is there anything you'd like to plug? And I'm sure there is, because, you know, this man get active, all right?
He's doing a lot of stuff. Like I was saying, he's a man of many talents.
Right. So.
Nah, just the website. That's like the central thing for everything, because fuck streaming. So.
I feel you.
Yeah. Firstlifelives.com. That's where everything is. You can get my social media on there. You can subscribe to the mailing list, all that, you know, all that good shit.
Nice. All right. Well, shucks. I guess we did it. You know, and the new wave doesn't end here though. Okay, the new wave will go on forever. As long as great men like Moulz Mel and Jonathan Cloud are here to carry it. Okay?
That's right. So,
yeah.
Well, we thank you for coming on with us. We do have, you know, a couple down the line, of course, that you were already scheduled for. You're still on those. So, folks, he'll be back. We'll be back. And the Electric Circus rolls on.
Dun, 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 dun. God, here we go. Not this every time. All right. See you for the next track, folks.
Hey, it's Mel from Rap Rankings. To hear the full episode this clip comes from and all of the other episodes, check the link in the description, stop by raprankings.com, or search Rap Rankings on your favorite podcast platform. And please consider liking, subscribing, and commenting to help us grow the channel and continue our journey as hip-hop's first and premier extreme podcast.